That's our goal. That's our heart, that God will keep us moving in the right direction. So never moving backwards. Yep, always moving forward. Because even if you take a couple steps backwards, you can get back up and start moving forward again. So you want to just keep moving in the direction that the Holy Spirit wants you to move and go in your life each and every day. So with that in mind, we want to just bring our prayer request. This is our opening part of the service. We do a pastoral prayer where I lead that time, and then we just go to the other part of the service with announcements and other, all those things that are part of our worship. Amen?
Amen?
Amen. We're here to worship the Lord in spirit and in truth. Amen? That's what the Word of God says, and that's what we're here to do, is worship the Lord in spirit and truth this morning. So with that in mind, we want to just praise the Lord for giving the youth protection, for watching over us as we were in Columbus at a youth conference, Reach Youth Conference, and just a blessed time, and blessed time just sharing with the youth this weekend. And we took about 12, we took 12 of them, and with Jenny and I, there was 14, so we had a whole band though. So we just had a great time with the Lord. So we praise God for that. Amen. Continue to pray for them and their growth and what the Lord wants them to do in their lives. So that's a matter of prayer, but also a matter of praise. And then we want to pray for our nation. Amen. How many people believe that our nation can use prayer? The leaders can use prayer. Amen. We can pray for them and lift them up before the Lord. And then also we want to pray for our church leaders. How many people believe that pastors, teachers, pastors' wives, all those leaders can use prayer? Amen?
Amen.
Amen. So we want to pray for them, and our youth leaders, and all those folks that are involved in ministry. We want to lift them before the Lord. And then we had several folks say that they were traveling this weekend, and so we want to lift them up before the Lord, that God will watch over them and protect them and give them strength and wisdom on that as they are walking in faith. And then those that have newly been baptized, we want to lift them before the Lord in that. Because as you take a step forward for the Lord, the devil always wants to try to knock you back. And so taking a step of baptism is a great step forward, and something that can really change your life and your mindset. But we want to just lift them up in prayer before the Lord today, and whatever they come to your mind. Then let's pray for those that are sick, afflicted, those that are going through difficult health reasons or health things in their life, and maybe that's some of you that you just want to be remembered in prayer today. Then for our unsaved loved ones. How many people have unsaved loved ones or friends or neighbors that they want to pray for? Amen. We want to do that. I wonder if before we go before the Lord in prayer, if you might have by lifted hand a request on your heart that you just want to bring before the Lord in remembrance of that today. Amen. God knows all about it. Will you stand with me as we go to the Lord in prayer this morning? We want to continue to pray for the Baptist Church in Southern Baptist Church in Texas. We want to lift that church before the Lord. God's grace and his mercy over those people. Sometimes we remember the tragedy right when it happens, and we forget to continue to pray or encourage after that takes place. But we want to just pray encouragement over those people, the pastor, his wife, their families that are part of that church there in the community, all the devastation that's taking place, not only there, but around the world. There's devastation happening every single day that we can bring before the Lord. Let's pray together. God, you are awesome in this place, mighty God. You are awesome in this place, Abba, Father. You're worthy of our praise. You are hands we raise. You are awesome in this place, oh mighty God. Lord, we know that wherever the two or more gathered together, you are in the midst of them. And so, Lord, we praise you that your people have brought your spirit today. Lord, we know that without a shadow of a doubt that this building does not house the Spirit of the Lord, but your people house the Spirit of the Lord. And the Word of God declares that, as it says, have you not heard, do you not know that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit? And so, Lord, we are the church. And so, Lord, I pray that we will be the church here today, Lord, that we will get out of ourselves and we'll glorify the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Lord, we know that no weapons formed against us shall prosper. Lord, we know that where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is unity. And so, Lord, we pray that the people of God that are here in this place will dwell together in unity, that you will speak to us through your word and by your word, God. I pray, Lord God, for Melissa, Lord, as she is going through this time of testing of her faith, that you will be with her and that you will strengthen her, Lord God, even though life sometimes brings those hard knocks that we go through. But we know a God that is able to just comfort us and lift us up and bring understanding to our heart, God. And so I pray that in the name of Jesus, Lord. I pray for all those uplifted hands that went up today for requests on each person's heart. Lord, you know all about them, Lord. You know if it might be for a loved one that doesn't know you, or a neighbor, or a friend, or maybe a disease or an affliction upon the body. But Lord, we know a God that is able to heal. Lord, and so we thank you, Lord, by your power, by your stripes, we are healed today. And so we pray for those that are unable to be in this house today because of ailment or illness upon their body, Lord God. And so will you just go and minister to them, Lord. Let them know that you are on their side and that you are the God that heals their body, Lord God. And so we thank you for that. And then, Lord, we pray for those other requests, for those traveling, for those that are on the road, maybe even at this moment, coming back to Ohio, Lord, that is a part of the congregation, Lord. We just pray that your hand of protection will be upon them today and that you will watch over them, Lord Jesus. We pray for all those that might be coming in, Lord, that you will strengthen them, that you will help them, God, and that they will make a decision to follow you in all their ways and all their thoughts, God. Lord, we pray for this church, Lord. We know that as we move forth and as the Holy Spirit grows greater in our lives, the enemy loves to come and attack. But Lord God, we know we place our lives, we place our children, we place our families in your hands, knowing that you are able to meet every single need. So meet us right where we are. Be in the singing. Be in the ushering, Lord God. Be in our giving, Lord Jesus. And be in the word today, Lord God. Let the word of Elijah not only in our hearts but in our lives, that we might not be just doers of the hearers of the word, but we'll be doers of the word, God. Help us to be doers of the word, God, and live it out, Lord Jesus, daily, that others will see you and that you'll be glorified, Lord, and they'll be brought closer to the kingdom. Oh, Father, we love you. We praise you for all that you're going to do, what you're doing right now, Lord God. We thank you, Jesus. We give you all the glory and the praise, and all God's people say, amen. Remain standing as we go and read our scripture together. We've been talking about being the Church of Acts, and so we are reading out of Acts today. Acts, the second chapter, we're going to read verses 42 through verses 47, and then we're also going to read James. And I want you just to take hold of what that has to say in the Word of God today. Will you just lift up your cell phone, maybe your Bible, whatever you have, and we're just going to repeat these words after me, please. The Word of God is my strength.
The Word of God is my strength.
So let me hear with my ears. Develop it in my heart. And most of all, live it out in my life. Amen. Be doers of the word, not hearers only. Let's read these scriptures together. Let's try today and do it a little bit different, and I'll read together all these verses. And just take what the word of God has to say in these verses to our hearts this morning. Ready on three, please. One, two, three, and read. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship, to the breaking of bread and to prayer. Everyone was filled with awe at the many wonders and signs performed by the apostles. All the believers were together and had everything in common. They sold property and possessions to give to everyone who had need. Every day they continued to meet together in the temple courts. They broke bread in their homes and ate together with glad and sincere hearts, praising God and enjoying the favor of all the people. And the Lord added to their number daily those who were being saved. Did you see the church growing? Amen? As they did those things that the Holy Spirit led them to do, the church was added to daily. Amen. How many people want to be a church like that? How many people want to go to a church like that? Amen.
Help us, Lord.
Yes, help us, God, to get this Acts church in our life. Let's read from James, the second chapter, these four verses. On three, please. One, two, three. Let's read. What good is it, my brothers and sisters, if someone claims to have faith but has no deeds? Can such faith save them? Suppose a brother or a sister is without clothes and daily food. If one of you says to them, go in peace, keep warm and well fed, but does nothing about their physical needs, what good is it? In the same way, faith by itself, if it is not accompanied by action, is dead. Wow, isn't that powerful? That's a powerful word right there. Let's take that into our spirit and then let's live by it and live with the word of God says. Will you just find somebody and tell them that you can hug them or give them a high five and tell them that you're glad that they're out in the house of the Lord this morning. Find a few people to do that too. Thank you. Before we do that, because I don't want us to forget, I'm going to ask Sister Jen to come and talk about OCC, because she needs to do that for a few minutes. This is collection week for our shoe boxes, and we don't want to neglect that or miss that.
Christmas Child. It technically starts tomorrow. We'll run through this coming week, today, Sunday. So we need to get in the mindset of getting your stuff together. If you need shoe boxes, empty boxes, I have plenty of boxes. I actually have plenty of items in here to even fill the boxes. So if you know you're not able to go shopping, but you want to just cover the shipping costs and write a check to the church for $9 per box, you can kind of sponsor a box if that's easier for you to do. Because I had the little girls this morning make boxes, and we've got, nine over there. I mean, I probably could easily fill another 20 or 30 boxes, but then just would need to cover the shipping costs. And so if the Lord needs you just to help us out that way, that's awesome. Operation Christmas Child, if you don't know, is part of Samaritan's Purse, and it is a ministry that's been going on since 1993, where families and churches and groups and so on, we put together little empty shoe boxes, and we fill it with all kinds of cute little gifts and school supplies, hygiene kind of thing. They go out to over 150 different countries, and they go out to children in orphanages and in areas where there's war and extreme poverty, and it's just a way to share with them some of your love that, you know, God gives it to us, and it overflows and we pour it to them. They are also presented with the gospel and given a gospel comic book, if you will, that there is also theirs to keep. And then recently, Samaritan's Purse has developed a discipleship program. So for every single box we put together, that essentially is like a missionary going out. And, you know, if you go online, I mean, there's just story after story after story of how churches have been started because of these boxes. You know, entire families get saved because the little gospel comic book that they get, they pass it to mom. Mom reads it. Mom passes it to grandma, passes it to the neighbor, pass and pass. And the word of God is going out. It's a great opportunity. Of course, you know, I would love to go everywhere and take care of all the kids and, you know, love on them all, but I'm one person who's stuck in Ohio. So this is a great way. Operation Christmas Child estimates that they will gather over 10 million boxes this year. That will go out in the next, in 2018. And we'll be back here again in November and start all over again and keep handing them out and sharing God's love. And so we just need a little bit of help. We need some more boxes. I know I've had several folks say, I got my stuff at home. Okay, now is the time. If you come on Wednesday for the church meeting, I think there's like a board meeting or something. Church meeting on Wednesday, or you can bring them next Sunday, or even for the Thanksgiving dinner, which is next Sunday night, if you need a little bit of more time. But if you have any questions at all, you can come talk to me, not a problem. You can talk to Wally back there. We're more than willing to help you out in any way. But we are just so blessed to be a part of it, and it really is so significant. And also, when you get your box together, put a little note in there to the child. They love notes. They love pictures. But also remember to pray. Pray before you start packing. Pray while you're packing. Pray after it, because it is so significant, the power of prayer. And there is just testimony after testimony how God will take a shoebox from James's hand, pick it up, and go hand deliver it to exactly the child who needs everything that's exactly in that box. And only, you know, it just blows your mind but it has to be God. We couldn't plan that. You know what I mean? It has to be a God thing. And so it's a very, very powerful tool the Lord is using, and we're blessed to be a part of it. Again, if you have questions, just ask me. We've always done so well. And so it's our opportunity again to just kind of continue to build the kingdom that way. Thanks, guys.
Thank you, Jen, for organizing that. Because in Matthew 28, it says, go what? Go where? All over the world. Amen? So we're glad to be a part of just doing this mission, that Samaritan's person. A lot of times this is a thing that people think they need to make up something new. You don't have to. There is plenty of ministry out there for you to do. Connect yourself with somebody that is doing a great job, that has already worked out, and you just do your part in it. And it really makes a huge difference. And we're so glad to be a part of it. This is, our eighth year or something? I don't really know. I know at least probably we've sent about almost 8,000 boxes from this place. And so we're not saying that to build our own self up, but we're saying that to give God the glory. Amen? Because it's all about Him and sharing the love of Jesus. So I think it just really sparks for our young people even to be mission-minded. And that's the reason why we had the privilege to send six young ladies to the Dominican Republic this summer. And it's changed their life for Christ. And they have grown stronger in their faith and their walk with the Lord. Just a few announcements that I have. And I'm sorry we don't have a bulletin. Our bulletin person was sick and they were trying to get it together, but they were unable to do that. And so, first of all, on Wednesday night is our congregational meeting. Twice. Really, we try three times a year to have a congregational meeting to let you know, as a congregation, what is going on with your funds that you give to the church, what our plans and our visions and our goals are for the year. All those things happen. And this is a blessing that it happens this Wednesday night, and we feed you before me. We feed the whole family. So that's pretty exciting, isn't it? And so we have soup and sandwiches prepared for that night, and it will start at 6:30. This Wednesday at 6:30, and then it will be over by 8:30. We're probably before that, but we want to just say to 8:30, definitely it will be over. Your kids will get to hang out. The parents will come in the sanctuary for the meeting after you eat, and we'll just learn what God is doing, how God is doing it, and what needs to happen so that the work can continue here at your church. Amen?
Amen.
Whose church?
My church.
Yep, that's it. This is not the pastor's church. This is not the leader's church. It's our church. We work together to make the kingdom of God, help the kingdom of God move forward. And so we wanted you to know that. And then on Sunday is our Thanksgiving banquet. We have that every year. We just come in as family. And this year we're trying to put together a little mini concert for our teens. And our teens and our children are going to do a mini concert before the dinner. And they're going to sing a few songs, do some of their gifts. And they're going to do that next Sunday. So today, there's envelopes that you need to fill out and say that I'm going to come. There's a small cost involved because we get the snow catered. Everybody does not bring anything. They just get to show up. Dessert, drink, food, everything. For a small cost, $6 adults, and that's 10 to any age of adult. And then $3 for kids. And that is 4 to 9 years old, $3. And so that helps underwrite that. So if you needed one of those envelopes, Minister Vince is walking around, and you can raise your hand and he'll get one of those into your hands. We hope that you bring somebody, because every event is not just so we as a church can just eat more and just hang out more. No, that's not what it's about. It's about bringing other people in that would not normally be connected to the church. And so we want you to think about that, and maybe you can bless their lives by being a part of that. Today is your last day to drop that either in Minister Greg's hand, raise your hand, so they know he's the organizer of this, or to give that in the offering plate. This is the last day. After that, we're going to lower our food number, and then we'll also do all the other things that we need to do then. And then next week you'll see in the bulletin our Christmas Eve schedule, our Christmas schedule for the year. And we always have a series of events that happen during that time. And one of those things is we have a Christmas praise service. We're in cooperation with, collaboration with other churches, and we all come together for worship night, and it's an exciting time, and it's just a time to pour out your love on the Lord and just say thank you for coming as a small babe in a manger and giving your gift of love and life to us. So that all those things will be in your bulletin. Also, about the New Year's Eve party, all those things will just be in your bulletin, so you'll be able to see that next week. And then we have started last month to do something that we call faith. Amen. How many people know what it means to walk by faith? Yeah. If you've been in church, you've heard that word faith. Faith is something that you don't know if it's going to come to pass, but by faith you believe that it's going to come to pass. Amen. It's a belief system that you believe that it's going to come to pass. So every single month, the Lord has just kind of put in our heart a faith goal in our finances, and then also a faith goal in ministering to people, because we don't want to just be a church that sits here and has a great sanctuary and has great grounds and never move forward. Amen. We want to be moving forward, because we're always moving forward. Well, yeah, never backwards. Yeah, we're always moving forward, never backwards. Sometimes it seems like we're going backwards, but you know that backward motion can move you forward to do greater works for God. And so that's what we're planning on and believing in. And so our faith goal for this month is a huge goal for our congregation, our size, but it's broken down to two things. First of all, we have a general fund that kind of makes our our lighting, all those things that need to happen in a church. You know, there's things, the same things that need to happen in your house that have to also happen in the church. And we are the family, right? We are the family, so we got to take care of God's house. Not just two people can do it, but if all of us get it behind it, then it can be a great work. And so our faith goal for our general tithes and offering for this month is $7,000. That sounds like a whole lot. But there's a lot of ministry. There's a lot of things that the Lord wants us to do in order for us to bring up that $7,000. But by faith, is it impossible?
No.
No, it's not. We had a whole message series on faith and walking in faith. It's not impossible. And then we also have another offering. Twice a year, we take out special offerings here to just help a ministry, but not just help a ministry, but do work outside of our church, to do work around the world. And so this year, part of our special offering that we're taking next Sunday, when are we taking our special offering?
Next Sunday.
Our goal is $5,000. So as a total for faith in our finances, we're looking for what?
$12,000.
Wow, that's a whole lot, isn't it? But together, going under the anointing of the Holy Spirit, we can do great things. Amen?
Amen.
I'm telling you, churches smaller than us bring $10,000 to $12,000, $13,000, $14,000 because they walk in faith and then they obey. I'm not saying all that because I don't want us to walk in guilt, because God says He doesn't want us to give if it's just out of guilt or out of duty.
Right.
But God wants us to give out of a cheerful heart.
Right.
And so I just want to ask you to hear what God is saying and then obey Him. If everybody obeys what God is saying, then I'm going to tell you folks, it's going to be more than enough. Amen?
Right.
But this time from our Thanksgiving offering, we want to send a gift to the church in Texas. The Lord just kind of connected my spirit with that pastor. I don't even know them. I've never ever met them. But the Lord just put in my heart, of compassion for those people, that if we were in the same situation, we'd want people to reach out to us.
Amen.
And so one way that we can reach out to them, I'm going to send them a letter that the Holy Spirit just keeps dropping stuff in my spirit. I'm typing that together, and it will be from our congregation. But along with that, we want to send them a monetary gift to bless them. Because there are things that we don't even know about that they're going to have to take care of.
Right.
In every one of their families. And they're doing not just one funeral meal, they're doing multiple funeral meals. And so we feel like the Lord wants us to bless them in this way. And so we want you to know that's part of our Thanksgiving offering. Not, I can say what portion of that, but part of it will go to bless them. And with the leadership comes up with $1 a month. So just wanted you to know those announcements, and there's a whole lot to know and a lot I've said, and maybe you drop it down on a piece of paper so that you can know it. But I just want to tell you what happened in our faith goal last month. Last month, our faith financial goal was $7,500. We were out two Sundays for the buddy walk, and then because my mom was ill during that time, I was there just being a family member. Amen? Sometimes you just have to be a family member. And I was being the family member, but also being the pastor. And you guys came around and blessed us on that Sunday. And so we never took an offering, but this is what God did. In just the 3 weeks of offerings, we did $5,927. We believe that if we would have been here on those other two Sundays, without a shadow of doubt, we probably would have exceeded our faith goal. See, when we all just mind the Spirit and we obey the Spirit, then we have to do amazing things. And folks, these dollars are not so I can wear a better suit or so that I can have a better car. These faith goals are so we can do greater ministry. The church is about ministry. The church is about reaching out. And it takes dollars in order to reach out. I can't say it any other way. Just as it takes dollars in order for you to have your house, it takes dollars in order for us to have a church and do the ministry that God wants us to do. And so I just wanted to encourage you in that and just say, praise God. Amen? Can we just put our hands together again and just bless the Lord? Thank you so much for being God's people and hearing God's voice in your giving.
Janae, you know my mind. Stand up, please. The people who went on a mission trip, stand up. Hey, I'm getting old. The name slipped my mind. My own name sometimes. My message to you girls is, keep living for Christ. Mm. anyone go out of your life and shine for the world. We need more missionaries. And I'm glad that you guys took that upon yourself to say, I want to follow God and not the world. Janae said that, and that is the most beautiful thing I've ever heard. You want to follow God at a young age. Mm-hmm. That is powerful. There's not too many young people out there saying that. But you took that alone. Don't let anyone blow out. You girls, don't let anyone blow out your life for Christ. Let it shine bright. Let the world know that you stand for Christ.
Amen.
You don't stand for Good Shepherd Church, because this is just a frame, but you stand for Christ.
Amen.
Yes. Yes. See, at a young age, I wish someone had told me that. They did. I don't know. I did, but I didn't listen. Because I wanted to follow the world. I wanted to be hip, do the things my friends were doing. But don't be a follower, be a leader.
Yeah. Right.
There's a difference. And I'm going to tell you the difference. When you're a leader, you draw people.
Right.
You can draw people to Christ by being a leader.
Right.
A follower, he'll just follow you right off a cliff if you lead him to a cliff. And you keep searching. Followers search for things. We wind up because I was a follower at one time. I just want to hang out with my boys. And that's what they did, I did. And I tell you, at least you're trouble. But if you follow Christ, you follow Christ, you'll draw many. Thank you for just serving our God. She woke up. She wasn't feeling good yesterday night, but she woke up this morning. She wasn't feeling good, so I was asked to pray for her. If you are a veteran and you served our military, we ask that you stand. All veterans. Jim Woodside, my son Charles, we say thank you guys for serving our country.
Yes.
And George. Yes, and George too. So thank you for serving our country. As we get ready to take the offering, we're going to ask the ushers to get ready. Ooh, you alright? You're a Buckeye, get on up.
Each and every person, everything said and done in this service, have your will and way in our hearts and our lives. We ask this in your wonderful, precious name. And the church said,
Amen.
Don't forget to drop your envelopes in for your Thanksgiving.
Hey.
We have no idea what that means. Yeah. None of us back here do. So you might want to
Does anyone have a praise?
Abby.
I'd like to pray for more ladies. On your mom, you can pray on your own. She had breast cancer, and first we were going to do surgery, but she had trying to get it out of the anxiety. And then they said they looked for all the medicines, and they didn't do that anxiety. And then she went back up the other day, and they said they don't know why, but the cancer is shrinking.
Oh,
wow. So I'm afraid to stop that.
Yes, amen. God is good. Yes, amen. Serve. How many people believe that our God is a mighty God? Amen. How many people know He's a faithful God? Yeah? Anybody know that He's faithful?
Yeah.
Anybody know that He's a long time God? Yeah? Amen. God is all those things and so much more. We can praise Him. We can lift Him up. We can magnify Him. For He is holy. He is worthy. Yes. Yes. Anyway, we're in the monitor now.
You come my way to see.
thank you that you are a portion. We thank you that you are a healer. God, you are a hope. You are a glory, God. You are more than enough for us, God. We bless you, Lord. We bless you, Lord. You are God's more than enough for us, God. We stand in you, Lord God. You are faithful. You are true, God. You are hope, God. We love you, Lord Jesus. Thank you.
Thank you. I love that new song that Audrey's picked out for us, that God is all that we need. He's a healer. Man, how many people know that he's a healer of all our diseases? Yes. God is all of those things and so much more to us. Praise God. Praise the Lord. God is good.
All the time.
Not all the time.
God is good.
God is good. Yes. We're going to break open the Word of God this morning and look at it. And I don't know if you caught what the theme is for today. If you got one of those sheets, if anybody get a sheet this morning that you can fill in, yes, if you want one of those. I tell people to take notes because then you can check out and see if I'm saying it correct according to the Word of God. We want to say everything according to the Word of God. I want to tell you that we live in a world that is just saying a whole lot of stuff. It's not based in anything. Amen?
Yes.
Amen? Yeah. But we want to say things that are based on God's Word. And so as you are studying to show yourself approved, or as you are taking notes, you have the right, and I give you the right, to go back and check me out. And if it's not right, come and talk to me. You don't need to do it in front of the whole group. I won't do that to you, so don't do it to me. But you can come back and talk to me and say, Pastor, I didn't get where you were coming from, or I didn't see this in the Word of God, and we can talk about it together and pray about it. First of all, I want to encourage you, talk to me and pray about it. You know, sometimes we think that we know something, but then after we pray about it, study it out, search it out, we find out that God is saying those very things in the Word of God. And so there's new truths, there's new revelations, because we need to be green and growing, not ripe and
rotting.
Okay? We want to be green and growing and not ripe and rotting. And so that's important for us in the Word of God. And we can do that through the Word of God. How many people want to be green and growing?
Yes.
Yes? We want to be a church that is thriving. Folks, I have to just tell you, I'm okay with it because I know that people are out or whatever, but I wanted to say to you as your pastor and as your leader, and you should be uncomfortable with it too, that we should want on most Sundays, unless there's a sickness or illness, we want to see every seat filled. Amen?
Amen.
Not for our glory, but for the glory of the kingdom. There are multiple people out there lost. Amen? I think that they said in a statistic that I read about, only 10% of Fairfield County is church. That's Fairfield County. That's all the suburbs that make up Fairfield County. Only 10%. So that's a lot of people that are in church. Folks, I don't want to bring them to Good Shepherd Church, but I want them to bring them to Jesus.
Amen.
Because if Jesus changed their lives, then that's what's going to make the difference. Then we want to connect them to a body of believers that is Bible-built, based, and Spirit-filled. Amen?
Amen?
That's the truth. It's not about bringing them to church. If we can get that all mixed up, and so we beat people down to get them to church. But folks, they can come to church every single week and not have a changed life. Yeah. But we want them to go out of this place and out of your life by having a changed life. Amen?
Yes.
And who can change them? Jesus.
Right.
Give somebody a high five and say,
Jesus
changes lives.
Life.
He changes lives. Praise God. We've been in a series of lessons on attributes of a thriving church, taking on the book of Acts, and we've been moving around the scriptures because there's connections to the scriptures in the book of Acts that are found in other parts of the scripture. And I want to just give you a heads up and let you know this, that if you are studying something God, I want to tell you at least three times that you're going to be able to find it in the scriptures. Because there are harmonies of truth. Amen?
Yeah.
And the reason why I say three times is I always say the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit backs it up. Come on. So if you're looking for something in the scriptures, usually you're going to find it three times. I don't know why I'm just saying that this morning, and I'm just kind of straying a little bit from my notes, and I'm going to get there because I don't want to hold you too long, but you need to know this because, folks, we're in a time when there's so many messages out there. There's so many philosophies. There's vain talk out there. Amen? And we need to be grounded in our faith. We need to be grounded in the Word of God. Amen? Because if you're not, you're going to be driven to and fro. Young people, you need to be grounded in the Word of God. Some of you guys are getting ready to go off to college, and I'm going to tell you, you're going to hear a whole lot of different philosophies. Even if you go because you're a Christian school, you're going to hear a whole lot of different things. There's going to be a lot of different religious bases. But you need to have a faith base that is based in the Word of God. That when people come against you, 20-somethings, when philosophies come up in your mind, then you know what thus saith the Lord. Because what's going to get you to heaven is what thus saith the Lord. And then what God says. Not what I say, but what God says. But if what I say is based upon what the Word says, and then you can take that to the bank with you too. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. That's the reason why you need to have your Bible.
Yeah.
Get your cell phone out or get your pen out and jot down some things. Because, folks, I want to tell you that the world is waxing worse and worse.
Oh, yeah.
Trouble on every hand. But we know that God is faithful. And he said, just because you see these things, do not think that I'm coming yet. You're going to hear rumors of wars. You're going to hear about wars. He said you're going to hear all these things. But be ye what?
Ready.
Are you ready? Because see, it doesn't have to be the end of the world when Christ comes back and blows the trumpet. It doesn't have to be that for you to be ready to take it off. It doesn't have to be that. Folks, I've been saying it, and I don't know why I keep saying it, but it just kind of strikes my heart about those people in New York. They were there on the bike path. They had no clue that that was going to be their last day. People went to church in Texas, and they had no clue that that was going to be their last day.
Yes.
And so it behooves you to get yourself ready.
Right.
The Word of God says out of Corinthians, it says today is the day of salvation.
Yes.
It says that. So if you're not saved, today is a day for you to get saved. I don't know why I'm just pausing and saying this right now, but I just feel the power of the Holy Spirit, and I believe the Holy Spirit has guided me to tell people every single week, it's time for you to give your heart to the Lord. And not talk about it, but do it. We're good about talking about it, aren't we? But we need to do it. We need to live out the Word of God. And let God come into our lives. This is your day. This is your day that God wants you to know him as your personal Lord and Savior. Amen. In the two texts we read today, we learned that a thriving church is a giving church. In Acts chapter 2, we see the church thrive as they gave. Amen. Did you see that? It said they gave to the needs of one another. Isn't that what you read out of that? Those 42 through 47. Did you see that? Did you guys get that this morning? And it said that the church was added to what?
Amen.
Daily. Amen? Doesn't that sound like you're thriving? If people are added to your pot daily, doesn't that mean you're thriving? Amen?
Amen?
Come on. Yes, it's thriving. The church was thriving. This was the beginning church. And so you see the church was thriving because the church was willing to, the people of the church were willing to give, or the church was willing to give. Guys, what makes up the church? This building?
No, the people.
The people. Amen? This is an empty building if you guys are not here. And it has the title of a church outside of it, but it doesn't mean that it's a church unless you come in here and act as a church. And so that's what was happening in this body, in the scripture, that the people in Acts were acting as the church. No matter what age you are, you can act as a church. Blessed be the Lord.
Amen.
In James it says, our faith is evident through our giving or our works. Amen?
Amen.
It said if you see somebody in need and you will not meet that need, then how do you say that you have faith? Because faith without works is dead. Amen? Folks, we can be talking about that I have faith and faith and faith, but if you're not going to do anything with that faith, and then you just have dead faith.
Mm-hmm.
Now, come on. How many of us want to be a thriving church? Raise your hand to be a thriving church. Amen?
Yes.
Since we want to be a thriving church, how do you think we should give? Good question. The scriptures lay out instruction for us on what we should or could adapt to our life in order to be a giving person. Let me say that again. The scriptures lay out instructions for us that we should adapt to our daily life. What did I say, could or should? It's up to you, right? God gives us instructions. How many people know that God gives us instructions on how to live successful in life? Amen? Amen. But it's up to you whether you want to do that or not. Amen? If you're a counselor and you give advice, you just give out the advice, and then it's up to the person whether they want to receive that advice or do that advice. Amen? All you can do is give it. And that's the same with the Lord. The Lord gives us instructions from His Word on how we should live, but it's up to you whether you should do it or you could do it. It's up to you. And folks, I want to tell you, if you want to have success in your life, if you want this church to have success, if you want to see the kingdom of God growing, we got to do it God's way and not our way. Amen? Did you hear what I said there? I didn't say do it our way. I said do it God's way and not our way. But we're more prone to do it our way because we are selfish by nature. Amen? Well, come on. See, Peyton, I just know that I know what's best for you. So since I know what's best for you, I know you should do it my way. Isn't that how we live? A lot of times we feel like we know what's best for somebody because it fulfills our selfish desires.
That's true.
Yes.
We don't like to think so, but it's the only way.
Yeah, come on. Hallelujah. Isn't God good?
All the time.
Isn't God good? Praise the Lord. I pray. I love His Word.
Mm. Yes.
Because His Word inspires me. It grows me. Mm.
Yes.
It gives me victory. You can say the same thing if you want to.
Yes.
It gives me hope.
Yes.
It gives me instruction. That's God's Word. And so I love God's Word.
Amen.
Again, let me ask the question, how many of us want the church to be a thriving church? Not just this church, but the universal church. Amen?
Right.
I want to tell you, if local bodies get on board,
right,
the kingdom, the universal body, the whole kingdom of God, the body that we're a part of, amen? There is one Lord, there is one body, amen? There is one baptism. That's what the Word of God says, amen? Isn't that what it says? So folks, even though we're a Good Shepherd Church here at South Mountain Spring Street, we're a part of a greater church. We're a part of the church in Africa that's serving the Lord. Amen.
Yes.
We're a part of the church in Ethiopia. Yes, that's serving the Lord. The church in China. Yes, amen.
Right.
We're a part of the church in North Ohio. Amen, that's serving the Lord. We're a part of the church in Cleveland, Ohio. Yes, the church in Arizona. The church in Texas. That's the reason why our hearts are broken for those people, because they are a part of our church. Amen. We're a part of that. If they have given their heart to the Lord and they believe that there's one Lord, one Savior, who died and who was born and died and rose again, they are part of our body. Amen?
Amen.
Yes, amen. Praise the Lord. God is a good God.
Yes.
If so, then let me ask the question, how many of us want to or are willing to be givers so that the church can thrive? How many of us are willing to be givers? How many of us are willing to meet needs so that the church can thrive? So let's take a look at a few scriptures that give us instructions on how we should give. If we look back at the second chapter of Acts, verses 42 through 47, we see there that the beginning church in Acts was a giving church. Amen? If you don't believe me, let me go back there and read it for you. I'm just going to read a couple of these verses. I have a lot of scripture this morning, and so I'm just going to flip through those scriptures quickly and read those scriptures quickly, and then just kind of go out of there and pull some stuff out of there that the Holy Spirit wants us to hear this morning. But Acts, the second chapter, those last verses here. And they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to the fellowship of breaking of bread and prayer. Everyone was filled with awe, and many wonders and miraculous signs were done by the apostles. All the believers were together and had everything in common. Selling their possessions and goods, they gave to everyone. What did I say?
Praise God.
Selling their possessions and what? And goods. They gave to everyone that had what? Can I just stop here for a second? There are some people that are in the body that will take advantage of that very phrase. But it said, everyone that was in the church, everyone. See? Some people just want to receive and not give. But everyone that was in the church gave as they had ability to give. They would sell what they had. They would, their possessions and their goods, so that the church would thrive. Everyone. Come on. The church is not an entitlement location. Because we're Christians don't mean that we enable you. Oh, come on now. You hear what I'm saying this morning? I don't know why I'm saying it, but the Holy Spirit is saying it this morning, and He wants us to get in our spirit. No matter what age you are, the church is not the place to enable you for your habits and your addiction. Oh, come on now. You hear what I'm saying? But the church is here. If you have a need, if you're hurting, if you're desperate, if you don't have housing, if you don't have clothing, the church is here to meet that need. If that need is really a need, amen, amen. Yes, come on. Come on. Come on. Do you know in American history that there was not the welfare system that came later on, but the church took care of people, amen? And I believe that's what God wants for the church. If we're going to be a thriving church, if we're going to be a vibrant church, to take care of the needs of the people.
Right.
But the world has changed the church into a welfare system. We're not the welfare system, but we are the people of God. Amen.
Amen.
Come on. Hallelujah. Mm-hmm. Hallelujah. We are here to meet needs. Are you hearing what I'm saying?
Right.
Look at somebody and say, He said. We are here,
to
meet needs.
Because
I don't know if you're getting that. See, some people will take that all the wrong way. And if you're on Facebook this morning, I don't want to tell you that we're not here to meet the needs of people. We're not here to pay. We're not here not to pay people's electric bills. I'm not saying that. We're not here not to pay people's cell phone bills. But we want to know that it's truly a real need. Because as a church moved about and met the needs of the people.
Right.
Hallelujah. Mm-hmm. Well, I'm not trying to beat you up this morning. Amen. Tell somebody, I'm not getting, the pastor's not trying to beat me up this morning. Amen. No, I'm not. I love you guys. I'm telling you that. I love you. I'm not trying to take you out of it, but I'm trying to give us freedom. Amen. Mm-hmm. How many people want freedom in the spirit? Amen. Freedom in God, amen? Freedom. Praise God. If you go to 1 Kings 17, 7 through 15, and that's a long passage of scripture, so I'm not going to read all of it for the space of time. But you see that there was a need in this passage of scripture. And people were willing to meet that need that needed to be met. And so you can go back there and read it. I encourage you to read that whole chapter there, and maybe read even the chapter before that. And then you see the great need that they had in that situation. And because of that great need, they saw that need and they met that need. Because they were willing to be what? Givers. They were willing to be leaders. I don't know if meters is a word. Correct me if that's not a word. But they were willing to meet the needs of people. In Luke 3, 10 through 11, what does it say there? Flip it there. You went too fast, yes. 10 through 11, let's see it together. What should we do then? The crowd asked. Jesus answered, anyone who has two shirts should share with the one who has none. And anyone who has food should do what? What does that mean? Come on. See, I didn't say it. See, this is the thing. Sometimes folks say, we always think that when we're meeting needs, it means that we have to give our finance. But folks, sometimes it's not giving our finance. Sometimes it's giving that can of food out of your cupboard to somebody else. Come on. Amen.
Right.
Sometimes it's doing something that you would not always think you would do in order to meet the needs. But meeting needs causes us to what? How does meeting needs cause us to act? How does it cause us to act? It calls us to sell or give things of value. Amen? See, if you go back to the book of Acts, I want to tell you their possessions were things of value to them. Amen? Anybody have some possessions that are things of value? Yes. They were things of value to them. Their property was valuable to them. Amen? They could have took their property and used it for their own good, right? Anybody ever had property and sold it? Yes, what happens? It allows you to, if you have some of the equity in that property, it allows you to have that money so that you can use it however you want to. And a lot of people want to use that money to what? Buy other property. Is that not true? So their possessions have value. But people, when they see a need and it's poured into them by the Spirit of the Lord, what? They sell and they give things of value. Amen? I'm reminded of the story from my father. We've known Sister Betty Price for a very long time. And she's talked about it here, and you've probably heard it before, that she had a husband, his name was John Bullock, close friend of ours. And he was taken tragically when his children were young. And because of it comes so tragically and so quickly, I can remember just like it was yesterday, all the events that took place. And because it came so tragically so quickly, they were unprepared to know what to bury Brother John Bullock in. But I'll never forget that God had blessed my father, Pastor Mike Dexter, who's the founder of this church. He had blessed him with a pinstripe suit that he loved very much. And those who knew him and maybe went to the church, you can remember what that pinstripe suit looked like. It was a gray pinstripe suit. It was a suit that he liked wearing. He felt like he looked nice when he wore that. I'm telling a little bit from my perspective here. But I'll never forget that he said that the Lord put in his heart that he needed to go in his closet. And he's like, God, I have other suits that I can give. You know, there's nice suits that Brother John. But God said specifically, go in your closet and get your pinstripe suit. Your great pinstripe suit. And what he did, he went in, got his pinstripe suit, so that Brother John Bullock could be buried in his pinstripe suit. That means what? He could get back, right? It's easy to give when you think you can get something back. It's easy to give a value when you think you can get it back. But it's harder to give and meet the needs of others when you don't know if you're going to give it back, or even if you don't know if you're going to give it back. Come on.
Right.
But when you're a giver, when we're a thriving church, when we're moving about in God's Spirit, when we're hearing from the Lord, folks, it doesn't matter. These material possessions don't hold any value because you know that heaven holds all to you. Amen?
Exactly. Exactly.
Seeing somebody's life change holds all to you.
Right.
And folks, you know what? That story has been told down through our lifetime at different times. Our father even shared that story. And I believe it probably touched other people's lives. And you know what? That example might even brought other people into the kingdom. We don't always see that. We don't always know that. But I know that when we give us unto the Lord, folks, out of value, out of our possessions, it blesses the Lord. And people's lives are changed because of it. That's what happened in the book of Acts. And if it happened in the book of Acts, I know that it can happen in the church of the day. Amen. I know it. But if we're going to give, folks, if we're going to meet needs, it's going to cause us to sell or give things of value.
Right.
Yes.
John wanted a pinstripe suit. He was saving for it.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. See?
And they didn't know.
No, we didn't know.
He got the pinstripe. Right.
I knew that he wanted that suit. I just didn't tell that him part. But I didn't know that I didn't know it was just any pinstripe suit, but they were saving for it. And God, even when he was not in his mortal body, he answered his prayer. See, God's faithful. Thank you for sharing that. See, you're involved in changing people's lives. When we give things of value, it changes people's lives.
And if we look at Exodus 17, 12, how else can we meet needs?
When Moses' hands grew tired, they took a stone and put it under him, and he sat on it. Aaron and Hur held his hands up, one on one side and one on the other, so that his hands remained steady till what? Sunset.
If you don't know this powerful story in the scriptures, God allowed Moses' hand to be raised in one battle. But meeting needs causes us to what? Be supported. Isn't that what they were doing here? They could went away and say, God, you have the power. Just hold his arms out there. Moses, do it on your own. But folks, I want to tell you that when we're called to meet people's needs, that means that we are supportive of people that, you know, maybe it doesn't meet our criteria, or it doesn't, they aren't doing all the things that we want them to do, but we believe that they're called of God, they're blessed of God, and this can help us win the battle here. And so we minister in their ministry because we want to be supportive. Mm-hmm. Cool. Meeting needs causes us to be what? Supportive. How have we lost that? Isn't it true that we're so quick to tell everybody what they can do, but we're not always there to tell everybody how good they're doing it? Come on. We've been sucked in on that, haven't we? Have we been sucked in on that? The world is so quick to criticize. I love what Joyce Meyer said. I love that she said, if you're not gonna help in the ministry, don't say anything negative about the ministry. That's my paraphrase, but she says it. I love that. Because so many times people are so quick to, well, if the pastor would just let the singing go a little shorter, and if he would just preach 2 points instead of 3 points, and then we'd get out a little bit earlier. And then did you see them? That praise team, if they would just wear jeans instead of dress clothes, that could make them be more current. You know, and so you just get, or maybe she's just singing a little bit too high. Or he's singing way too low. Or we get so critical of everything, we just start nitpicking one another. Isn't that true? Or even in our house, isn't that true? But instead of looking at it, how can I encourage them? I just want to tell you today, you know, you might have struggled in giving your notes, but I want to just tell you that you are called of God. God loves you, and I know that he is preparing you for things that we can't see but are happening in the spiritual realm. Amen?
Right.
But we get so critical because we forget that when we are supported, we are also in the needs of people. How many people like to be encouraged? Amen? How many people know that it takes 10 words, it takes 10 phrases of encouragement to do what one day did?
Right.
Take 10 things of encouragement to do what one day did. So what if we did 10 encouragements? And then only said what the Spirit wanted to say on other things.
Right.
Now sometimes after you encourage, you forgot what you were going to say. That was not possible. Is that not true? Try that with your husband and your wife and your kids. See if that makes a difference. But just as these brothers were being supportive of Aaron, when we need needs, see, he had a need. His arms were too weak to hold up any longer. But God sent these guys. God is sending you along to help somebody, to support somebody.
Right.
When we meet needs, we realize that we can be supportive. And if we look at Galatians 6:2, what is it saying? Meeting needs causes us to what?
For God, who is at work in Peter as an apostle to the circumcised, was also at work in me as an apostle to the Gentiles.
What is it saying again? God wants us to meet the needs of every person in the universe.
God is not partial to one culture, but he is
loving and concerned about every individual person. And he calls somebody to carry the burdens of each and every one of those people. But also in the scriptures, there's a scripture that says that bear ye what? One another's burdens, and what? So fulfill the law of Christ. So we're meeting needs when we what? Bear ye one another's burdens. What does that mean? Anybody carrying a load? Anybody carrying some concerns? Does not load seem a whole lot lighter if somebody else helps you carry it? Amen? See, I could have done that this morning. I could have brought some bricks in and just kept stacking them up so you can get the illustrated picture here, but I didn't do that. But I could have put a load up on you. And if somebody would take that one of those bricks off there, would the load get lighter? Folks, we meet people's needs when we carry each other's burdens. We're meeting needs. When we pray for somebody, we're meeting their what? Come on. See, folks, you think that it's always about giving. It's always about selling. It's all about your finances. It's all about your groceries. No, sometimes it's just about taking out time to pray for somebody. Sometimes it's about just taking out time to say, what's going on in your life? If that's going on in your life, I want you to know that I'm going to just start praying for you. I didn't even know this was going on with you, but I'm going to start praying for you, Sister Jill, because now I know your burdens, and I just want to be there to support you and lift you up. And you know, she goes out of there feeling a whole lot lighter than what she came in feeling. Amen? Is that not true? Meeting people's needs. It's not about how much you can give. It's not about all these other things. But it's about taking time and building what? Relationships.
Yep.
Oh, come on. Come on now. Yes. Let's look at Hebrews chapter 6, verse 10. What else? How else can they meet needs?
In Galatians 6, 2 was about carrying each other's burdens.
And I did the wrong scripture. That's not that. I read the wrong scripture from Galatians 6, 2. I put it wrong in my slide. That shows my neediness. Hebrews 6:10. God is not unjust. He will not forget your work and the love you have shown him as you have helped his people and continue to help them. Well, I did my part already. Come on. What did it say? How can we meet people's needs?
Continue.
Well, I did my part already. Come on. I think you guys are here. We can meet people's needs when we will continue to help them. God wants to grow the body sometimes, but people just jump ship before we get to the point of what? Amen? Growth? Amen? So sometimes God is saying, continue. Just continue to pray. Continue to give. Continue to do this. Continue to do that. Don't give up. Folks, we give up when we're just at the point of seeing somebody's life being changed because we're meeting their what? Needs. Come on. Continue to help. Hebrews 13:6. How else can we meet people's needs? What does it say?
So we say with confidence, the Lord is my helper, I will not be afraid. What will mortals do to me?
That's wrong. Let me flip there in my scripture.
I think it's Hebrews 6:13.
Yeah, I probably got it backwards. Inverted the things. And then we do not give me authority or power, we do not have strength.
Well, it's 6:10 through 12. I mean 13.
God is not unjust. He will not forget your work and that the love you have shown him as you have helped his people and continue to help them. We want each of you to show the same diligence to the very end in order to make your hope sure. We do not want you to become lazy, but to imitate those who, through faith and patience, inherit that what has been promised. When God made his promise, and then just talk about the promise there, but this is the whole thing. What does it say here out of this passage of scripture? Really, you see it throughout the whole thing. Do good, right? We're meeting needs when we do good. How many people want to want somebody to do bad to them?
Right.
We meet needs when we do what? Good. Let's go to John 15:13. I know this is right. I apologize. In my human flaw, in my hurriedness, I put it in all scriptures. Looked at the right scriptures through the week and then put it in the wrong scriptures. Hebrews of John 15:13. Greater love hath no man than this, than a man what? We meet needs when we are what? Willing to lay down our lives. What entitles our lives? Our agendas, right? Our plans. Well, this is into my plan, I can do this. Folks, I want to just tell you it's okay to have plans. But if the Spirit is leading you to do something out of your plans, then I want to tell you, you want to follow and go up. Because it's great, no greater love hath any person than to lay down his life for a friend. And who was this talking about? This is talking about Jesus laying down his life for each one of us. Wasn't that great love? Did he meet our needs because he laid down his life for us? Then who are we supposed to imitate? Who are we supposed to mimic in our life? Christ, amen. So if Christ laid down his life for people, then folks want to let us know that we need to be willing, if we're going to meet the needs of people, if we're going to be a thriving church, we need to be willing to lay down our lives for the cause of the kingdom. Amen?
Yeah.
I didn't say for our cause, for the cause of the kingdom. To see somebody brought into the kingdom. How many people want to see people brought into the kingdom? Yes. That means that sometimes, folks, I'm going to have to give up the way I want to do my agenda, how I think it needs to be done, because God is doing it a different way, and I'm okay with it because I'm willing to lay down my life so other people's needs are met. Isn't that difficult? How many people have a difficult time laying down themselves to meet the needs of others? Come on. Just think about the people in your house. Sometimes God has called you to do the greatest your greatest ministry inside your household.
Right.
And sometimes God is working in somebody's life totally different than the way you think it should be done. And so you have to be willing to be patient and wait on the Lord and see God's hand at work. And that means you've got to lay down your will. Life because you love that. Isn't that difficult? Amen. Our God is good because it helps to meet other people's needs. What else? Matthew 5. How else can we meet people's needs? In the same way, let your what? What?
Light.
Let your what?
Light.
Let your light shine. What is your light?
Light.
Your faith. Your salvation. He's the light of the world. Folks, I want to tell you, if we want to see a change in the world, there's a lot of trouble, there's a lot of hate, there's a lot of all these different things that are going on in the world. And how can we change them? How can we see something different? And I love it because Tuesdays I get to share some time with Minister Greg as we talk about the finance, but really we just talk about the world and what's happening in the world and how we're a part of it. And so we just talk about things that are on TV and stuff like that and how God wants us to sow into it and see something different. And he said that one of the sinners stood up when they were talking about all the pain and the hurt that was going on. He said, what the world needs is love. But then he started to say, they need a God to touch him and give him his love. And they shut him down. They kind of took him off the air right at that time. As we're talking about that, because they don't want to hear that. But I want to tell you folks, if we want to see
want to see hate change. We want to see guns change. It's not about doing all these different laws. It's about seeing a change in the heart. Amen.
Amen.
That's it. It's a change in the heart.
Yes. Very much so.
Folks, you hear it in these programs. They'll tell you. And you can work these programs, but if you don't come to God at some point in your program won't work. Is that not true? This is a counselor back here, my friend. My friend Jason and Francie. She's a counselor. She'll tell you. They can work their program, but if at some point they don't turn to some greater power in their life, which we know is God being the greater power, they seem to flip back. They do need healing. Folks, I want to tell you, I believe in counseling. There is pain in people's life that they cannot go and move to where God wants them to be in their life because they have some pain that they need to overcome. And we need people that are God-centered, God-based. But that's letting her light shine. Hearing their problem, hearing their needs, and then letting her light shine in there. That's not just for you, that's other people, letting their light shine. Folks, I want to tell you, if we want to see a change in the world, young people, if you want to see a change in your school, adults, if you want to see a change in your job, let your light shine. That's meeting people's needs because people are looking for hope. People are desperate for peace. People are desperate for joy. They're desperate for all these things, and they don't know how to find it. But we know where they can find it. They can find it in Jesus. I didn't say in the church. I said in Jesus. He is our hope. He is our peace. He is our joy. He's everything that the world says in need of. It's in Jesus, and He's the light. If we're going to meet needs, we've got to be the light, folks. We've got to be the light. Because the world is getting darker. I'm going to tell you, if I turn off all these lights, it would be a little bit dark. But it's not as dark as what's happening in the world. There's a lot of things happening in the world. There's things that are covered that you don't even know about that is happening in dark places of the world. But I want to tell you, what stops out Satan is the light of Jesus. Yes. It's time for Christians to rise up and be that light and meet people's needs.
Yes, amen. Exactly.
Not just talk about it, but be about it.
Yeah.
We can talk about it, folks. The church has talked about it for centuries. People are sending missionaries to America, the land of the free, the home of the brave, because we're missing out on the light.
Right, that's exactly right. Yeah.
It's time for us to show them. You can come here, but still we have the light. We still have the power. But the Word of God says this, in the last days there will be a form of godliness, and they'll deny the power thereof. The church has started to deny the power thereof. It's just not forms of godliness. Hallelujah.
Yep.
Hallelujah. But God has more power for us.
Amen.
Because He's the light. Amen. We have something, folks, that people want. Don't let the devil tell you that you don't make a difference. Folks, somebody in your life is looking at you. Yeah. Janera, somebody's looking at you. Yeah. Because you say you go to a church. They're looking at you. And they're looking to see something different. Yeah. Are you being that difference? Because they need a need met. And that need is all of us have. All of us have a God void in our life because we are created in the image of God. Will you share the light? I'm not saying share it like I'm sharing it. Share it how God wants you to share it.
Right.
How can I share it, Pastor James? By doing good.
True.
By being supportive. Sometimes people only listen for somebody to listen to them. I want to tell you that somebody, God has placed in somebody's heart a ministry for our senior saints. I call them senior saints. But for our senior citizens, they really have that ministry. You know what? Senior citizens are not looking for somebody to come in and turn their world up upside down. They're just looking for somebody to come and listen. And be a supportive person. Do you hear what I said? God has placed that ministry in somebody's heart. I believe God. I'm speaking in the word of authority this morning. That God has placed on somebody's heart. That you just can minister. You understand them. You relate. And you're not even their age, but you just understand them. And God has put in your heart to be supportive. Because you want to meet somebody's need. You're willing to walk in that ministry. Almost there. If we look at Philippians 2:4, how else can I meet needs? who being in the very nature of God did not consider equality with God something used to his own advantage. We meet others' needs because we become others' blood. It's not to our advantage, but it's to Christ's advantage. We become others' center. Not about me. It's all about me. It's all about me. It's all about me. It's all about me. No. We become others' center. Do we live in a world that's other-centered? Folks, if we're going to meet needs, if we're going to be a thriving church, if we're going to be a church in the way we got it through before, we got to be what? Other-centered. We're not looking for our advantage, but we're looking for Christ to be lifted up,
right,
to be glorified. Mm-hmm.
Right.
Why did Christ hang on the cross? Because he was what? Other-centered. Why didn't he embrace Christ? Because he was other-centered. Christ gives us an example. God, Christ lays it out for us. If we're going to meet the needs of people, folks, we've got to be other-centered.
Help us, Lord.
I want to just encourage you this week to do something. Start in your own house. Make this report. God, I want to meet the needs of those in my house. So I want to minister the way you want me to minister in my house. So God, help me to be in my house other-centered. Other-centered. Not that it brings me advantage, God, but that it brings you glory. Folks, because can I tell you something? Can I tell you something? We can say, God, bring revival to America! Bring revival to America! But I want to tell you that revival needs to start with us first.
Right.
Do you hear what I say? So often I say, God, bring revival. But start revival with our house. And then take it to what? The Capitol. And then take it to the what? White House. And then spread it all over the nation. We can write revival, and revival can come to America, but unless revival starts in us, revival will die as soon as it comes. Mm-hmm. If our lives change, we're revived, and our hearts are renewed in Christ, then the world will change. Mm-hmm. Revival. But let us start with us, Lord. Not for my glory, but for your glory. Then last of all is this. Luke 12:33-34. We're wrapping up. Sell your possessions and give to the poor. Provide purses for yourself that will not wear out. A treasure in heaven that will not be exhausted, where no thief comes nor near, and no moth destroys.
Right.
How can we meet that? How can we meet the needs of others? Demonstrate the matters of the heart. Doesn't it say that? It says, where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. What does it say? Right here it says, provide purses for yourself that will not wear out, a treasure in what? Heaven. Let's take that back. What does it say? And another scripture says, where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. Realize that, folks, I'm not trying to build treasure here on earth, but demonstrate the matters of the heart. What's going on in your heart? Because where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. So if your heart is not for what? Meeting people's needs, and then it will show up where your treasure is. What's going on?
If we're going to meet the needs of those around us, our heart needs to be in line or in tune with who? With who? If we're going to meet the needs, folks, I can tell you, our heart has to be what? In tune with Christ. Because, folks, I want to tell you, I don't know if you're like me, and I call myself a pretty not unselfish person, but I have to, when I really look at my life, I have to say that I'm prone to be more selfish. And if I'm going to be unselfish, I'm going to have to be more like you, Christ. I'm going to have to look at my heart. I can't look at my heart, but David said it this way. He said, search me, O God, and know my what?
Right.
Heart. God, am I a person that just talks about me the needs of people? Or am I a person that really wants to meet the needs of people? Where am I? What's going on? Can I just say this? People will not believe that you care until they see how much. How do they see that we care? It's by meeting their well. Just in closing, I'm here standing as your pastor named Cass. A guy named Bob realized that it was not about getting somebody to come to salvation. But first of all, in order for them to come to salvation, he had to do what me the night where they were. He knew that my dad might have another honey because they were in the same place. So what would Bob Utley do so he could come talk about Jesus? He'd bring a new dog. And then he heard their conversation that my mom said, they loved him. I also he wanted to see them know Jesus on the inside. He brought one. And folks, it wasn't just one or two times. It was a persistent over a period of time. And then at some point in time, they came to say, we'll come and go to church with you. And because of that, God was already speaking to their heart and their hearts were changed. And it just didn't affect them, but it affected their 8 kids. And many of them are serving in the kingdom of God because one hand met the needs of individuals. And when he met the needs of individuals, it brought them to the greater good, which is Jesus Christ. See, do you understand what I'm saying? Meeting needs. If you see somebody out there, you say, go to your own church. You just might miss out on an opportunity to share Jesus. Have you ever thought that every single day that God sends you into the same gas station and you think you're just buying a bottle of pop, but really you might be listening to somebody that has something in their life that they need that? Sometimes we get so involved in our own world that we miss out on meeting the needs of others in their world. And right there, God tells you how you could reach out to them and you miss the whole thing because you are busy in your own agenda. But folks, I want to tell you, if we'll give the heart of Christ, and if we demonstrate the heart of Christ and be filled with his love, then we'll learn how to better meet needs. I miss it. Can I admit? I miss it. I miss it sometimes. It's right there in front of me, but I miss it. I miss it with my wife. I miss it. God has showed me how to minister to her, and how to be effective for her, and how to show her that I love her. Folks, but I miss it because sometimes I'm too busy in my own world. Anybody else?
Yes.
Do we miss it with our neighbors because we're too busy in our own world? Do we miss it? Do we miss it with our kids because we're too busy in our own world? Do we miss it on meeting the needs of others? When needs are met, the church thrives. The church lies. I apologize again that I have these scriptures out of order. Because I only want to preach the word of God, nothing else but the word of God. But today, folks, it's more than having the scripture out of order. It's about hearing what the Spirit says. And the Spirit says, we are called to meet what needs. We are called to meet needs. And we can meet those needs if we'll do it God's way and not our way. Amen? How many people are going to be willing to do it God's way?
Amen?
Let's not talk about it, but what? Let's not talk about it, but what? Because we're not just hearers of the word, but we are
doers
of the word. Let's do the word. Let's do the word. Let's stand together as we pray together. Lord, we love you. We praise you. And Lord God, we want to always be equipped and ready with the word of Christ in our hearts and in our mind and our spirit, that we will speak those things that you have called us to speak and do those things that you have called us to do. Lord, we thank you for your spirit. We thank you that your spirit is alive. God, I pray that as we leave this place, we will not just talk about meeting needs, but we'll go about looking for needs to be met. And then as we go about looking for needs to be met, then we will do the work of the Father, and then we'll shine as a great light, Lord God, and that people will come into the kingdom because of what you have called us to do in our lives, God. Lord, help us not just to talk about it. Help us not to just let it go in one ear and out the other, but help us to bury it in our hearts and then go out and live it out in our lives. Lord, we love you, we praise you, and we thank you. We ask all these things in the precious and the beautiful name of Jesus. And all God's people say,
amen.
Amen.
Please remember, if you have given your envelope to the collection office, you can give it to Minister Craig. We're all dismissed in the name of the Lord.